Puss Marianne. Apartment because Jack Kerouac and Philip Whalen were in town. for one of those nights where lots of important, intense talk about writing you don't remember later. Well, Diane had promised her babysitter that she'd be back at 11:30 that night, and 11:30 starts rolling around, so Diane bids her farewell. Whereupon Kerouac raised himself up on one elbow on the linoleum and announced in a stentorian voice, "De prima, unless you forget about your babysitter, you're never going to be a writer." How do you like that? Kerouac just props himself up with one arm and drunkenly slaps us with the great fear we all share. He embodies the archetype of the selfish, self-destructive male artist, and he announces that unless we too are willing to be irresponsible to our relationships, we'll never quite measure up. I consider this carefully then and later, De Prima writes, and allowed that at least part of me thought he was right. But nevertheless, I got up and went home. Three cheers for De Prima. "I'd given my word to my friend," she explains, "and I would keep it. Maybe I was never going to be a writer, but I had to risk it. That was the risk that was hidden, like a Chinese puzzle, inside the other risk of, can I be a single mum and be a poet?" A serious question, that one. Serious not only for mums, but for all of us. Can we be present in our relationships and still do the work we feel called to do? It's like my friend Lynn says, a woman has to make a real effort not to dissolve into everything that needs her. Our relationships need us, but we don't want to dissolve. We refuse to dissolve, but we choose also to be responsible for our relationships. We're tired of the drunk guy on the linoleum telling us we can't do both. Women have always done both. Looking back, De Prima recognizes what is true. Had she opted to stay that night, there would be no poems. That is, the person who would have left a friend hanging, who had done her a favour, also wouldn't have stuck through thick and thin to the business of making poems. It is the same discipline throughout, the same discipline. And discipline, like motherhood, is good for the soul. Poetry is good for the soul. Responsibility to all our dysfunctional relationships is good for the soul. The archetype of the selfish male artist tells us that we can't manage all these things at once, that we can't be simultaneously responsible to children, babysitters, self, and art, that we have to sacrifice to abandon, but we know that's a lie. As I write this, Kerouac has been in his grave for nearly 40 years. Diane De Prima is down in San Francisco, mother of five children, author of 35 books of poetry and several memoirs, powerhouse and 21st century radical. We don't need children to be happy, but motherhood has taught me this. To experience joy, we have to be able to honestly experience darkness too. In responsibility to relationship, we build bodies of memory and life experience that we can be proud of. Motherhood has taught me that the opposite of happiness isn't struggle, it isn't even depression. The opposite of happiness is fear and obedience. In Revolutionary Letters, De Prima writes, "Be strong. We have the right to make the universe we dream. No need to fear the groveling apology for things as they are. All power to joy, which will remake the world." Three cheers for De Prima, for motherhood, for the courage to make the universe we dream.
Your mother, but I think the sense of responsibility, the sense of kind of letting go of me.
something about responsibility and attention to our responsibilities, our friendships and our connections. And they can see that can seem really paradoxical. How come we talk about these things in relation to one another when actually they absolutely do they do require one another.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's not just children's responsibilities to our lovers, to our friends,
yeah,
to our families, to our parents, and the whole thing, isn't it? It's
yeah,
not, you know, if you can just imagine Carol up on one arm saying, "Go let your mother die." You don't have to go. It seems a bit crazy now hearing that. And how long ago was that?
Yeah,
50 years ago.
Yeah.
To hear that kind of comment.
Mm.
But I've heard comments similar recently, and I think it prevents women from really progressing, because there's always that little voice in your head that says, you know.
And it almost makes you feel like there's no point in even trying.
Mm-hmm.
So if I want to be responsible, if I want to sort of uphold these values, then I won't be able to be that, so I might as well not try.
And the same for men, I can say it comes from the patriarchy, but what does that mean? You know, it's, I think men have changed a lot, and are changing a lot, need to change a lot, and women's attitude to themselves needs to change a lot.
Mm. But so we do labour under this mythology. It is something that we're all aware of. Anyone who's an image maker, engages in any way with the art world, we can't not have it in our consciousness, this feeling, isn't there a right way of going about it? I would say happily, I'm very much beyond the point where I consider any of those things, I think. I don't think they enter my mind anymore, but I think most of us do go through a process of having to slot these things off and having to engage with them in order to rebut them.
Mm.
But it's amazing. I think probably anyone who's been working as an artist, particularly a female artist, for any length of time, can recount occasions where someone has said something which implies that we're not doing it right.
Mm.
As though, because there is, you know, I mean, there are modifications to it, inevitably. There are numerous examples of it. But there are kind of, there is this kind of embedded sense of what constitutes a real artist.
Mm.
So much of that is built around a particular kind of mythology. There's a story that I told Marie Anne, and she prompted me this morning to tell it again. To tell you this story. Is she there?
Yeah.
She's there. many years ago, when I was very young, I knew an artist who was quite well known in the area where he lived, not so much beyond that. And there was a lot of mythology built around this guy, and I had decided to have a couple of painting lessons with him, so I thought that would be interesting and useful. And I've always tried to get to know, when I was growing as a young artist, because I didn't go to art school beyond foundation. So I've always tried to encounter different artists and glean whatever I could from them as a process of kind of design my own way of growing and learning. And I knew this artist guy, and I decided that I would have a couple of lessons with him and see what I could get out of that. And he noticed while I was painting, according to his instruction, that I was very orderly in the way that I presented my palette and my belongings and my paint. And he said to me, "If you put the lids back on your paint tubes, you'll never be a real artist."
What?
And I remember thinking, I know I don't know much, but I know that's not right. I know that's not right. But it persists, this idea that we know this one, don't we?
Mm-hmm.
If you aren't slovenly, like Francis Bacon, for example,
mm-hmm,
studio's legendary.
But it has to be the right
cavern.
Kind.
But it has to be the right, yeah, it has to be the right kind.
Yeah.
Of mess.
Yeah.
Yeah. But there's so many ways in which people absorb ideas around what's the right way of doing things.
Mm.
When really the really interesting and most freeing thing. But it's amazing how you have to keep renewing that thought. Mm. I thought, like I say, I feel kind of beyond that point. But we are always renewing that thought. But there were no rules to being an artist and the ways of being an artist either. But it's amazing how it's like that there are.
Do you think that those ideas have anything to do with art education or not?
Some other ones are, yeah.
I can honestly say I've never come across anything like that. I've never felt anything like that. I don't know if that's just because I did not go to art school and be self-taught. And I don't see the rules. I don't care.
Mm-hmm.
But that may be just my personality because the background I come from.
No, you're just a force of nature.
But it does kind of lead me on to like the conversation we had the other day where we were talking about entering competitions and kind of networking and this kind of idea that sometimes it can feel a bit forced, like I should do this, this is the right way to do it, I should attend this event, I don't really want to go and I don't really feel comfortable around these people, but I should do it and I should make an effort, and this whole kind of like, yeah, way of kind of how you grow your career as an artist, and actually that like if it doesn't feel right, it's not going to work out for you. Because you're not going to be comfortable in that, and actually finding your own way of doing things, your own kind of people, and then you can kind of grow something of your own, which is obviously something that we're kind of doing, or trying to do with this, is kind of finding people that you gel with, finding kind of similarities and ways in which you can work together, and growing a network in this kind of way, where it doesn't feel sort of
forced.
And contrived,
yes.
You know, but I think that's the same thing as this kind of idea of this is how you should do it.
Mm.
This is how other people are saying you should do it. You should enter this competition. You should do this.
Mm.
So there's a lot of, maybe no reserve is kind of, also just allowing that to slip away, but not give up, but instead just find your own way, which is a lot harder than kind of trying to go that path or giving up.
Maybe you just won't explode, exposed to all of those male tutors, etc., and how art education is developed anyway. Would be that. I remember listening to a radio program, it was about writing, and the guy was saying that he was educated at school where it was in the Times, it must have been the 70s or something, where they were throwing away all use of grammar, and it actually gave him freedom. That when he was made left to curate the National Portrait Gallery for a while, or show there, he had to be taught grammar because, but yet his own writing is so sort of free and it seems revolutionary. It's quite free flowing in the language he used and everything. Because he wasn't educated in that sort of strict way. I heard those kind of comments quite a lot when I was at art school, and I'm a lot older than the rest of the Infems group and grandchildren. And it was worse then. It was worse then, but it still persists. But surely you found a similar attitude in business, for example, as a woman. There you go.
There's so many stories about my other life and attitudes, whether that was towards my gender, whether it's towards my race, sexual harassment, all kinds of things.
Mm-hmm.
And you can only, you're only supposed to do this type of job, and you're supposed to look pretty, and you're supposed to, present yourself in a certain way. I was a medical representative, so I was going around speaking to doctors and pharmacists and sometimes professors. At one point, it was a hospital sales specialist, so I got quite high up in what I was doing. So it was very high level, but it was very, very masculine dominated, top heavy with men at the top. And then the reps were, they tended to pick young, good looking women, have to dress a certain way, this kind of thing. I do still have some friends who are in that business, and it's improved a lot, but there's still a lot of that kind of thing going on. We just wouldn't get away with the kind of sexual harassment that I have to deal with. that we did back then. But yeah, so there are some similarities, not necessarily in terms of dress and things. I think find that for me myself as an artist more so than in terms of the way that I present myself. But certainly in terms of the kind of attitudes that you had towards ambitious women and men wanting to take you down if you were ambitious, like literally having to try to take you down through spreading lies and rumours and all sorts of things. I have come across sexual harassment and those kinds of things in this world as well. And it's meant that I've had to be tough, as many women have had to be tough in this world.
And it's really brought back to your practice now and what you're prepared to put up with.
Oh yeah, 100%. As an artist. And then there's a lot that I learned from the business world that I brought into this world, and I've taken over business now. Mm-hmm. And after some time, you develop a reputation, and people know not to mess.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a very incestuous small world, so people get to know it. Yeah. But at the same time, yeah, so people have respect, and just allow you to do your thing, which it's kind of a shame that we even have to have that conversation.
Mm. Do you think there's an extent to which being a female artist means that you're just talking about certain mythologies that surround more of the kind of male archetype of an artist? Do you think there's a sense in which as a woman that there are less of these kind of imprints, these templates for working, so that might potentially afford us a certain kind of freedom to create one of our own, loads of one of our own?
That's a really good question.
She wasn't always the most present mother, and that he was kind of sad about that. And this kind of, I feel that there's a question there of if she had been a father instead of the mother as the artist, would that still be a problem in the same way?
Yeah.
Would that still be brought up in the same way?
Mm.
I don't think it would. And I say that because, remember, just today we were talking about my friend, a male artist, who, fair enough, his partner are not together, however they have a son, and he is an incredibly successful artist, and he gets to fly all over the world doing residencies and things for like 3 months at a time, and he comes back and the child's daddy, you know, and meanwhile it's the mum who is taking care of business day in day out, and I could say quite confidently that when that child grows up, he's going to be saying how great it was to have a celebrity artist for a dad.
Yeah.
He's not going to be talking about, oh, my dad wasn't really around that much because he was off being a celebrity, he was off being successful.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
because it's seen as such a masculine thing. I feel.
Because it's more permissible. Men are more involved with children, child-rearing now, most of them are, than they used to be. But it is like it's okay for a man, you know, the male artist to...
There is still that.
Who is it that said the pram in the hallway is the enemy of creativity. But, yeah, I think...
which shows that is exactly what you were reading about before.
Yeah.
Have any of you ever encountered when you were a younger artist and you found that you were starting to make work? Did any of you ever encounter a situation where people would not accept that it was your own work? Because when I was younger, I encountered there were a few occasions when I was accused of a kind of plagiarism. Or I was asked, did you make that? You made that? Was that actually you? Or who helped you with that? It persisted for quite a long time, you know, because I'm pretty much sort of taught like Adelaide. Apart from a bit, I started a foundation course and then I thought, this doesn't suit me, I'm going to leave. There were many occasions where there were these moments when people say, oh yeah, but you knew this, you must have, who was the person that you knew who taught you how to do that? So surely there's a piece of the puzzle missing here, isn't there? And awful, really patronising. So there's such an important component in taking ownership of the thing that you make. I mean, that's one of those questions, I mean, it's something that we end up having conversations about quite a lot. How do you get to a point when you're really fully comfortable with taking ownership of the thing that you make? I mean, that's such an exposing thing. It's something that is a kind of renewed exposure that you get more accustomed to and you're more comfortable with inevitably over time. Whereby you can stand with your work and you know that it is your own and it's exposing, but that is an acceptable and actually welcome part of the process of communicating with an audience and having that kind of exchange. But it's very curious when you're younger and you're trying to forge a path where you're trying to find a place where you can claim ownership of the thing that you've made. But also you're coming upon people that are trying to, that can't quite accept that you have actually made that thing that you produce.
You think that's in part because of the fact that, you're obviously exceptionally skilled at figurative painting, and that's traditionally associated with the male genius. Right? So, as a woman, you're not supposed to be the muse on the model of a mistress. You're not supposed to be the genius painter, and you paint like that. So, they look at you and they think,
where is the missing piece?
Yeah.
And I think partly because people imagine that they must know what that missing piece is. Where is that? How does that feature then within this landscape? Can we figure out where they come into play? I mean, I've been accused about plagiarism.
Except for editing the video.
Really?
That's the only thing.
Yeah.
This was from people who like you, just because I had no experience in working. Video before.
This is your first film?
Yeah, it is. There was kind of some question. This was from some friends who do editing who were then slightly irritated that when I said yes, I actually did do it.
I would like to challenge one assumption, which is between yourself and Adelaide, that you actually learn anything at art school. There's this sort of myth that you go to art school. Those of you who've been to art school, and how much do you learn? How much did you learn? And how much was it about you working with other people, just as you would, you know, meet other artists? Because there is a bit of a myth about, the secrets all in art school, and really,
I learned nothing.
Maybe a few techniques, even that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
was a lazy bunch of tutors that were always getting off at students and spent a lot of time in the pub. That's as far as I can talk. It was this, we mustn't interfere with the creative process, a bit like I was saying about the time when this writer was going to school and they were going to teach grammar. You know, this was a long time, probably 35 years ago, 40 years ago. Oh my God, I can't think about it. So I think, and then what do you learn, as we were discussing earlier on, you can learn techniques.
Yeah.
And I used to get a lot of people would come to, say I do a sort of evening class years ago and teach portraiture, and they'd come and you know, say, how are you, oh, I've been doing classes for 20 years, you know, but they never really developed their own language and their own style, and their idea about becoming a good artist was to learn as many skills as possible. And when I've done this, and when I've done this course, then I'll be ready to start my own work. Whereas actually, the thing was, they lacked ideas. And it's all about having an idea, or having something to say. Even if that thing you want to say is just about placing one colour next to another, and making it vibrate, that's just as valid as, you know, other things. I'm not creating a hierarchy about what is important or what isn't. We all have our preferences.
I think, yeah, the idea of kind of being ready is really important as well, because I think, you know, a lot of us hold ourselves back because we feel like, again, that thing of like showing your work, being seen, being sort of standing by what you've done, being like, oh, I'm not ready, I'll just do this and then I'll be ready to show, or like, I'll just keep working. And I think it's really important to just show as soon as possible, even if it's not ready, you know, just to kind of get used to that.
So my experience at art school as a mature student, so I know that I got much more out of my education as an older person than I would have as a 19-year-old. Mm-hmm. Personally, you know, some 19-year-olds do fun. Technique, not really taught that much. So my education is in the last decade. A lot of space for ideas. I'd say that arts education in the UK is far inferior to a lot abroad. It's less robust, and you are kind of left to your own devices. I still felt supported throughout both my degrees. But two things I would say, well, three things I think. One is, for me, it just gave me a time to focus on my practice, which as a mother would have been difficult without. So it kind of validated what I was doing. Secondly, it's really interesting to note that most of the staff and the students in both our courses were female. And thirdly, while I had really great support on both my courses, there was a complete lack of representation, which made that difficult, because my work comes from my lens, from, you know, from my cultural background. And you have to, in this country, I still think you have to be very self-led, and you have to, you get out what you put in currently. Yeah, but I wouldn't have it any other way. I am a good experienced person.
I agree that it's that is really important as a way of kind of validating the time and effort that you put in. And that is one of the main things that going to arts education really, really gives you, is that time and space to say, this is what I'm focusing on now. And it's a dedicated time that you're doing that in. I think for me, it's the same. I did my MFA 10 years after I did my BA, and I think it was much, much better because I had time to actually develop my own practice and get to a point where I was like, okay, now I actually need that interaction again.
Yeah.
And that's what it gave me, was actually having that feedback and interaction with different artists that I didn't have because I was very isolated. Just worked in my studio from home, like most of the time, yet didn't have that much contact with other artists, which then became, on the one side, quite lonely, but on the other side, also just creatively stifling, because sometimes you need to just feel that input, you need to have that, to see what other people are doing, and kind of you feed off each other creatively. So I think, yeah, that
and
is
it is so peer-led, the courses in this country, it's very peer-led.
Completely.
Especially in LA, I think the tutors
think definitely there would have, like, technical stuff would have been so much better to have more of it. I mean, the one thing that was really great, my tutors, but the technicians in the workshop, that was amazing, actually having that kind of like technical like guidance and the access to all of the facilities that you wouldn't have at home. So I think that's what it really gave, was fully access to facilities. But there, yeah, I agree that there's, it's lacking, definitely, in terms of what we're doing in different countries. Yeah.
What about your experience, Marianne? Because you did, you did your PhD.
I think mine was probably quite different because it was a very, at the time, a really unique creative arts degree that was interdisciplinary. We were in a village, so it was quite a hothouse. We were sort of away from, let's say, cultural things. And I'd say that apart from this way of teaching me to think in an interdisciplinary way, which I've never really forgotten when I'm teaching, for instance, art history or anything, I always think in that way. The biggest thing it probably also gave me was just there's one contact that I'm still friendly with, who has, I've got so much work through this one person that I met that because I was in his performances at university. We lost touch for 10 years, but he's a curator now, runs an MFA program. I got to work at the Venice Biennale, I got to do loads of things that wouldn't have happened if I hadn't met him. So it could just be that one person that you meet in that context that then changes, you know, your practice in a way. So I was quite fortunate, I think, being uni.
Yes.
But again, it wasn't the obvious choice at the time because everyone thought I should go somewhere and work at TA or what have you, to Goldsmiths, or you know, why are you going to some place in the middle? But yeah.
That's just reminded me of Rebecca and I were talking about, there's an article on Artsy that talks about some of the most successful artists in history. They've done this very comprehensive research and discovered that it had actually nothing to do with their talent or what school they went to, and everything to do with their network. And I think that's one thing that art school gives you, is a good network. That's not to say that you can't develop it. If you don't go to art school, I've managed to develop a really good network over the last 16, 17 years through exhibitions, through interviewing artists and making friends with artists, through the studios that I have worked within and the friends that I have made within those studio complexes. I mean, one of my studio complexes, Thameside Studios, was one I started at in Woolwich in South East London. Was where I met somebody who completely changed my entire practice with one critique, just changed everything. And from the point that everything changed in that way, in terms of what I was actually making, my whole career changed and opened up in the way that I hadn't imagined I was even ready for at that point in time. So I am very much feel that that research is proven in me and in so many other artists I know who are, not that I'm saying I'm remotely successful, no, I'm just saying that I see the benefits of having a really, really good network and nurturing relationships with other artists, with curators, writers, everybody who's working within the ecosystem that we call the art world, really.
But again, you can do that in a way that isn't that kind of conformist way.
Exactly.
That I'm told about, because, I was saying before, when I was in London predominantly, I kind of felt I didn't do as much of that networking because I didn't feel comfortable in the situations that I was going into, and it's only after I left that I started doing that, and it's because I kind of, the sort of anxiety about this kind of, oh, I should be doing this, I should be doing that, and it kind of then, I put this wall up and I just couldn't do it. So it's kind of about, then developing these networks in a way that feels kind of right and familiar.
And authentic.
Exactly, authentic, that's the word I'm looking for. Thank you.
The name is like quite, sorry, a
I just want to make an observation. My background is 30 years in business and 10 years slowly through sort of craft and design into fine art. And it just strikes me that everything you're talking about, it's the same in the business world, it's the same in every world. I know we're focusing on the art world here, but to me, it's more kind of interesting thing. I know it's not quite the intersectional that you talk about, but it kind of is. Mm. These are life problems, life problems for all kinds of people, particularly for women, especially women, you know. So rather than ghettoising ourselves in the art world, maybe it's also just interesting to think about it in that widest context. That, you know, these are just, I don't know where I'm going with that, but just sort of widening the conversation out, not to feel like this is a specialist thing, although it does have some kind of specialised traits, but these are generally things that we're facing in the world, in all walks of life, and thinking in that context.
So one of the really broad life problems that is often not discussed, in particular in relation to the arts, is the socioeconomic one. It's nowhere near discussed enough. Well, how do people do it if they have no money? And it's one of the things that most people face. How can you do this if you're from a working class background? How do you do this if you don't have funding, if you don't have much? I speak as a working class person who have no financial support and found it very difficult and forged a way forward, nonetheless, that it was very perilous indeed. And I read with interest today, on the way up, I saw that there was an article in the Guardian, which is why I've got my phone out and I'm paying attention, that the university regulator has confirmed that it will be cutting its funding for art subjects by 50%. And today, the Treasury is understood to be keen to reduce the number of students in England studying courses producing lower salaries, and therefore less likely to pay back their loans. So there's an active intention currently to make distinction between different kinds of courses, different kinds of programmes, which may have some kind of financial recompense at the end of it.
But that's
trying to form some kind of,
That speaks to the conversation earlier about the fact that education, to some degree, the gist I'm getting from is education feels a little bit devalued now. Education, you know, hugely has become a business that needs to return.
Bring business as an artist in the real world. There is a real sense in bringing what could be described as business practices into your way of operating within the system so that you can survive it. Artists have to be pragmatists, particularly if you don't have a lot of money. You have to learn to be adaptable and really pragmatic. I should know.
Well, the arts, you know, is a huge part of the GDP of the country.
Well, this is it. It produces a really social society. Don't get me started on the subject. But you shouldn't be bringing that business mentality in the way that you fund the arts. It's enormously short-sighted.
Mm-hmm.
As you know, Bob and Roberta spent in all schools should be art schools. I mean, you don't have to have gone through an arts education. Obviously, I've not really done it. But inevitably, there are all sorts of things that you can learn, which you can bring to bear in your wider experience. Lots of people find that, you know, that people might have learned a few rudimentary techniques, or as a form of communicating.
We have a responsibility as artists and being collectives and organisations, but we make sure that artists get paid fairly.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's really, really important, this whole kind of attitude of doing things in kind and in favours. Well, you can't pay your rent in kind.
It's a whole internship culture, isn't it? Again, it goes to business too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think that's absolutely right. Just to interrupt, but you know, I realise we're saying this at the same time. We didn't give you an artist fee, we didn't write ourselves an artist fee, and there is a point where when you're self-funded, you either you don't do the thing at all, or you decide to invest in it.
But there's a different capital here.
Capital
here.
It's a capital exchange.
And we, you know, we're supporting one another, and that's really important too.
If we paid ourselves and didn't pay you, that would be a very
different.
No, I'm not paid.
Loss-making exercise. that's one of the most important things.
We lose money every time we do these things. We spend money to.
But this is where we've got to try and find different avenues to do it. I think it's really important.
But I agree, and it's for people at every level to stand up for themselves. Inevitably, if you have emerged, as they say, you do have a responsibility to make it clear that you expect to be paid.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Because then you are laying that trail for others.
Mm-hmm.
You know, even if you can afford, even if you're at a point where you can afford to do something for free, you shouldn't, because then you're setting in motion the expectation that, you're in a good setup, you must have the bank and mum and dad to help you through this.
Mm.
We all have to set an example.
So again, it's a comes back to valuing as well.
Valuing the value in yourselves, and isn't that a pertinent issue?
Do you think we should maybe wrap it up by asking the question of, how do we change this? How do we create a kind of environment where we can kind of change this paradigm, where we can change these kind of ways of doing things, these expectations?
Well,
more than
for me, reflect on something or something. I've always felt it's individual. You as an individual do the best you can to the people you work with, the people you're involved with, in whatever small or big way you can, it precipitates out. And to me, that's always felt quite a female point of view.
Mm.
You don't necessarily, try and look at the bigger picture. It's just, what you can do, day to day in a small way. In your world, and it will precipitate that.
That is something about paying attention and having that. I mean, it and goes full circle back to what I was reading earlier.
Exactly.
That goes against that kind of idea that you trash everything, you trash the hotel room, and throw the TV out the window.
You can do that too.
I'm actually working on something right now with another artist that we haven't taken largely yet, because we're still working on the document. But basically, the idea is to organise, is to create kind of like the equivalent of a unionised structure, right? In which, and I know there is an artist union in the UK, but it doesn't function in a way that is conducive to producing the results that we want at the moment, right? And so myself and another artist who is not a female, Amate Golding, he's an amazing artist, he's a very, very good friend of mine, and we have been brainstorming for months. We have monthly meetings to really work out and hash out. There's another a couple of artists who are working on something to do with fair pay for artists as well, but we're really thinking about how to structure something such that artists can become members, as soon as you leave university or as soon as you decide that you're an artist, and all of that feeds into a structure whereby there's a legal entity at the centre of it, and that legal entity helps to advise, helps to ensure that everybody knows what their rights are, helps to ensure that the right contracts are in place, so that when you're having conversations with organisations or other arts entities, you know what to ask for in terms of pay, and you know you've got a support structure behind you to help you, so that you can have that confidence. Because I think there's one thing that so many artists have in common is not having the confidence to know, actually, what are my rights?
Yeah.
What am I supposed to be paid? You know, should I push back against this gallery who's taking a mickey out of my life? Should I push back against this institution and taking a mickey out of my life?
Mm.
So many artists get a commission, and people think that, because I'm a sculptor and I've got this amazing commission. But actually, everyone thinks that person is doing so well. If you look at what they're getting paid, it's ridiculous.
yeah, it's true.
Because the production costs, nobody takes into consideration mm-hmm. what the artist is being paid. Everybody else on the team gets paid, but the artist isn't getting paid.
Yeah.
Right? So to have a structure in place, I think that would be so that could revolutionise everything. Because then everybody would understand, actually, no. And if artists, not even institutions, if galleries, if all of the people in the ecosystem feed into this thing such that you get almost like a trust pilot tick against your name. And if you're not signed up to that thing, nobody's gonna go to you. You're not gonna get business. You're not gonna get the commissions. You're not gonna get X, Y, and Z, right? If we move into a place like that as an ecosystem, then I think it will be a completely different place for artists. We won't be sitting here having these conversations. Nobody will be feeling they need to be broke and sitting in cold studios where toilets don't work and there's no heating. How ridiculous is that? In the 21st century, that you can be in a studio where your heating doesn't work, where your Wi-Fi doesn't work, you're paying studio money for the studio.
Yeah.
These kinds of things happen, and these are the kinds of things that if there's a central structure in place to ensure that everybody has to sign up to minimum standards, nobody has to suffer.
But they had that in
the finish
of the decade.
Exactly.
It's still
staff,
but it's still
good
work.
I mean,
it's
like
the idea.
I think what the musicians union as well.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's still staff, and it's still work. I mean, it's great empowering and informing people, but it's not going to save the world with the greatest respect.
It's a good start,
it's
though.
It's a fantastic start.
It's a good start, and we have to start somewhere.
Absolutely.
But it's all well and good, everybody saying, but to say everybody has to do their bit, yeah, great. However, the majority of people who I speak to, they have no concept of what their rights are. They've got no understanding of, because there's no central place necessarily that you may have artist network or something, but how many people actually go on there and read anything, right? So if there is something solid in place whereby people, that the whole ecosystem can, I think, maybe I'm a dreamer, I don't know, but I really do believe that it can change things and it can make the whole thing a better place. Mm-hmm. And if there's a good solid foundation, right, then it can just only improve, it can only get better over time. Mm-hmm. But if we just leave it as it is, and that's just the way that it is, nothing's going to change. Mm-hmm. No one will change.
It certainly should be part of curriculum.
Exactly.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I think one of the things that you can do informally is to have an open conversation, an honest conversation about experiences. It's one of the things that drew me to us working together. So the idea that we could actually communicate about what we might have been through, the experiences mm-hmm. we might have had. And there have been times when I've likened it rather to the Me Too movement. People, artists, a lot of female artists in particular, are very afraid to speak out about having had really poor experiences mm-hmm. with galleries.
Mm-hmm.
But I know lots of artists who've had terrible experiences, male and female, at the hands of galleries. And there's an assumption there that they hold the cards, they have the power.
Exactly.
We can't speak out against them. Mm-hmm. We're in isolation,
yeah,
we need
black
them, but they need us.
Mm-hmm.
We speak here as people who've been really fortunate in having worked with Andrew and Stephen, and it's been an incredible experience to work with you, because I mean, it's going to get embarrassing.
Mm-hmm.
But it's been wonderful to work with them, who answers emails, has been incredibly accommodating and kind.
Mm.
And
you're looking after
your daughter, and it's now looking after you. But it has been enough. I mean, I did say that to you in the pub, so it's not, you're not that surprised. But it has been an uncommonly good experience to work with Leicester Contemporary.
And at the moment, you're seeing a shift in the art world a little bit towards
there is more
care.
Yeah, there is.
Self care, support,
yeah.
And kindness and warmth.
Yeah.
We've had the pandemic, we've realised there's new ways of working, we've had lots of movement, so I feel like it's quite a second time.
In some ways it's more atomised though, and more people dispersing.
Yeah,
I think it's different in different environments. It's probably different here than the way that it is in London, which is more competitive for a start. I speak as someone who's predominantly in isolation, I work in isolation, and I know lots of people. But I choose my life that way, and you know, that's how things happen, that's my life of choice. But London is not the same now as it was pre-pandemic. So it's dispersed. So many artists have gone to the elsewhere. So I think we don't know how the dust will settle yet. I don't think we know.
The original thought was in London that all of those businesses that have closed down, and people working from home, you know, they're all going to open up the studios, but I'm not seeing that happening.
Yeah.
More likely they'll be allowed to be converted into flats or something.
Yeah.
If it does happen, and then there's the whole thing, people working from home, people can go back into business environments, or is this going to be, it's for all of us, we don't know.
Yeah.
You know, we need dust to settle, don't we, a bit before we get to know what might happen.
There's all sorts of things that people like to say who are on the outside, who are not artists. Things that are kind of rolled out regularly. Hello! and one of them is, artists, when times are bad, artists get clever and they take over spaces and they make things happen. And you think, it's all very well. It's like during the pandemic, and to a point, right, you say, artists all had a much better time, didn't they? And they found it much easier during the pandemic, didn't they? Because it's what they do anyway. They're used to being alone. I would say it was split 50-50. I saw on social media and I heard by various friends, I know loads of artists who couldn't make a single thing because they couldn't thrive. And it doesn't mean that they didn't have the inner resources. That would be ridiculous. It didn't mean they didn't possess the inner resources to make things. We're social animals, and lots of artists work best when they are in communication with other people and other artists, and they cross pollinate. And that's what's exciting about making things. I'm not that creature, but so what? You know, some of us are fine. Anyway, I happen to be one of the people who's just gone. That's me. But you know. I know loads of people who couldn't deal with it. People love to kind of roll out these ideas that the artists, they're all so resourceful, aren't they? And they'll make things happen no matter what the circumstances. But often that's an excuse for treating us.
Yes.
And not paying us, and not giving adequate resources.
Yes.
Yeah?
Pay everyone else and they're not like so far.
Do you think that's down to fear in some way that artists are sort of. Of course we're all
but if you give us power, we'll take over the world. If you give us resources,
it's just an unknown, isn't it?
We'll run the asylum.
It goes back to that idea of mythology, artists' mythology.
Yes, it
that
does.
There's a fear because you're this kind of strange, archaic being,
yeah.
And it's a way of neutralising it to treat it as something other. It goes back to this.
But it's also partly about a commodifiable mythology.
It's
about, going back to is that about that mythology that's created, as Rihanna rightly said, it's an historical model which persists. I think
and how valuable is art?
Yeah,
to a society with those.
And why does that? Yeah, it is an industry. It's a massive industry.
Yeah.
It should be rewarded because it actually is viable.
Yeah, but that's just speaking to the capitalist.
But it is, the construct
and model. Yeah.
And it shouldn't have to be. It shouldn't have to have a which we need as well. But it shouldn't have to. It shouldn't have to have this kind of.
But by all accounts, we're in very very late stages of capitalism. So it'd be interesting to think about different.
Oh, we're in the late stages, are we?
No, very, very late stages.
Oh, right.
We
don't know what's next.
Yeah, and we're in interregnum.
Yeah.
If you listen to the sociologists, so it's some of the things you're talking about might start to foreshadow different ways, different systems, different economies. That's where it gets interesting for me.
I think it's interesting when you ask yourself a whole set of questions.
Mm.
And is what do you value?
What do you value?
Is it all about the new Porsche, or
And are you playing into an idea of just going back to the idea about supposed truths and commodifiable ideas about what it is to be an artist? Recently, that kind of goes back to also in the way that we talk about that artist has a significant mental health problem, and that's what we like to talk about. We talked about that earlier in our conversation. Equally, that goes for deprivation, artists who work in poverty and deprivation, and the way that that's romanticised.
Mm-hmm.
I had a studio visit recently, and be here, and not in Leicester, and that, how does that work? How does that work? And she asked me, she asked me, do you ever feel that, do you ever miss, I can't remember exactly how she worded it, but something along the lines of, did you ever miss the time when you were really poor? Because do you ever feel like when you were really poor and you were really struggling, do you think you took more risks? Do you think what you made was more risky, more real? Do you think
that's
better?
That's the realness, right? It's that kind of idea that if you're poor, then you're like actually real.
The Adele syndrome.
Yeah.
She has to get miserable before she can write.
Yeah.
How has it affected your work, this success?
Yeah.
That kind of thing.
Yeah. And I have to say, I know only people who have never been there, only people who don't know what it's like to have nothing and to come from a really working class background, romanticize.
Mm-hmm.
Not having anything and having to make stuff anyway.
Mm-hmm.
If you've been there, it's not romantic.
Mm-hmm.
And that goes the same for significant mental health problems.
Mm-hmm. Trauma.
And trauma, etc. The
mm-hmm.
way that these things are talked about, the way these things are discussed is though, well, isn't that your gift?
Mm-hmm.
Isn't that a lucky break? You know?
Yeah.
That does partly go into when things are seen as a kind of commodity, as a pithy, nice little wrapping up of how we're going to sell the work that you're
doing. It'll tell us what it's like to be traumatised and never experience it, or mental health or poverty. It's
well, we draw on all of these things inevitably, but we don't want to be reduced by it. The point is for it to be expansive and a point of communication. And something fertile, but so is health, and so is joy, and so is strength, and so is security potentially. And I said to her, you know, I take more risks with my work now, or my work takes more risks with me in the way that I see it, because I'm just doing their bidding, whatever comes into my mind. But being at a point of being more secure means that I can take more risks.
Mm.
Actually, no, that's not how it is at all.
Mm.
Mm.
What is class in this country now? Like, I don't know how I would categorise myself class-wise. It's not something that has ever really occurred to me, really, what class I belong to.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
But that might be something to do with your background, your family.
Heritage.
Yeah.
But also there's like 7 or 9 classes now.
Oh, it's extra ones.
Yeah.
It's like gender, isn't it?
So you can work in class, but cultured. So you know you're higher up on that run. So there's a lot more classes now.
There was like a questionnaire quiz or something.
The precariat.
Exactly. I was like, what? Oh,
yeah, there was it's still there. There's an online Guardian. I think it was on the Guardian. It might not have been. I saw maybe it's not on the Guardian. An online cogitator. Remember the correct term was. Where you could input your earnings, and but also your
social circle and cultural capital and everything,
which is again one of the things that nobody ever talks about, cultural capital, and a sense of access, a feeling that you have access to things, access to culture, access to conversation.
Access. That's an interesting one.
To
get the access available. In different ways.
That's what certain types of education sort of not guarantee you.
Yes.
Smooth the way. That's the point of why people are there.
Yes.
Yeah, and if you don't have that on earth.
But don't you think it's about confidence as well? So much of it is about confidence, and there's certain types of paid education that make you come out into the world that you're really confident, and furthermore, you're much better than all those other people out there.
That's what they do.
You are the superior. You have the superior gene.
That's exactly.
And they make you believe that, and so you come out and face the world in a different way. And I think that's a lot of our problems.
That's the patriarchy.
I think it runs across the board with women and men, where they come out, feeling they are superior.
Yeah.
And you're raised thinking that you're a higher being. It's a bit even blighted, but it's true.
Yeah.
With women and men. So, but then if you're on the other end of that, you're never quite good enough.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then if you're a woman, and then if you do stupid things, like show your work to stupid people and then take on board what they're saying, which I've done a lot more. If you want to show it to him, I might as well show it to the gas man. How is he going to understand half an hour?
Don't make preconceptions about the gas man.
To get that response, because it's got to be someone who can respond to the work. And I have to say, more women respond to my work because of men than men. And I think it's because they find it more accessible, whereas maybe some men, I'm just supposing here, find it, some of my women, a bit confrontational, should we say, because they look them in the eye. I don't know, you tell me. So should we questions though? Do you want to ask us any questions, you guys? Because we're all sitting here shivering, waiting to go to the pub. So, any questions? Any thoughts?
Can I ask you guys a question? Just going back to the business art world thing. Have you... did the support networks within business women versus the support networks within art amongst women? Do you think there are more or less?
There are more support networks among women.
In our
business.
Or
what do you think, Marion?
In business, there's more formal networks, aren't there? I've been established a while, and the Chamber of Commerce, etc., networking for women, whereas in arts it tends to be more informal.
Well, there's AWITA, which is relatively new, 3 or 4 years now, 5 years. Association of Women in the Arts. It's a very good network.
That's relatively.
Yeah, 5 years. So I think definitely in the business world there are a lot more.
They're charging £250 a year. I mean, it's a lot. All of these things cost.
If you apply as an artist, now they've even opened up a competition of the image you can apply as an artist, and if you know somebody who's in there. And they can recommend you. Then you can get a bursary.
I've personally found that people in arts individually are far more supportive than I've ever found any individual in the business world. I mean, it's really cut.
Oh, really?
And I found the art world. I mean, this is an example. I've 30 years in business, and I know I'm a natural learner. I don't particularly like being part of a group, but I never had any help of any formal kind. In business, not at all, quite the opposite. But I found generally within the arts, particularly amongst women, exclusively amongst women actually, more or less, just much more kind of one-on-one, just warmth and support for what you're trying to do.
I know quite a lot of professional women. And my understanding, very generally, is that there is more of a sense of fraternity, let's say, within a business environment, and that women generally find themselves isolated within institutions and within business environments, and are much more inclined to make networks and connections with them outside of that environment, and to connect with people who are operating in different business environments, and to find the point of connection and means to communicate.
Yeah,
and that's quite interesting because then you get much more of that cross-pollination going on. I think women are more inclined that way rather than bonding within the pre-existing unit.
Yeah. I must state my experience is exclusively creative industries where there are, but I found the art world, individuals within the art world, much more supportive.
I have to say, regards to the gender question, my personal experience has been I have had amazing support from men. I've had amazing support from men and women. It's a different kind of support that I get from men. So I have 4 mentors, and they're all men. And they all happened by accident. But it wasn't like, there's only one of them actually who I approached officially to mentor me. But the rest of them happened by accident because they are friends who support my practice, and these aren't guys who are trying to get it on or anything like that, it's nothing like that. One of them is 100% gay, and the rest of them are men. And I found them to be incredibly supportive, to the extent that one of them is actually has been a patron of mine. He was a patron for years, and when he wasn't patronising me in that sense financially to ensure that I didn't have to work so I could focus on my practice, he was regularly buying work to ensure that I could really focus. So there's that. For me personally, I feel like if as a woman, if there are men within this who you respect and trust, don't feel that you can't approach them to, whether that's speaking about your work, whether that's asking for support in some way, and not all of mine have come through necessarily asking, it's just come through extended conversations that has led to the point where, okay, now I've got this mentor type relationship. One of them is a philosopher and writer, one of them is a lawyer, one of them is a filmmaker, you know. So it's interesting. And then with my group of women, it's a different type of support. It's more like like obviously the Infems collective, there's another collective, the BBFA collective that I'm in. And then at the same time there's this whole art girl gang who, you know, we go to each other's shows, we critique each other's work, we talk, we complain, we support, all of those things. So it's much more of kind of like an emotional support than necessarily and sometimes practical, especially with collectives, but with the wider girl gang, it's more emotional. And with the men, it's very, very practical, a lot of problem solving, and even sometimes writing, all of those sorts of things. So I would say
don't diss all men.
Yeah, no, just don't, not even that, just don't be put off and think about men in the sense that, oh, because
they're not going to be as supportive,
yeah. Because they can be, my experience since being in the art world, more so than in business, definitely. In business, they all just seem to want to get their leg up. But in the art world, the supporters that I have in the art world have been incredibly, genuinely supportive, where it's so heartwarning sometimes, for both genders, but I would
say...
And
it must be like your work, you know?
Mm. Yeah.
I think that's what it's about, the end of the day, it's about the work, isn't it?
Yeah, definitely.
When you support or understand the work.
I've been supported by both, by men and women.
Yeah, I have.
I'd say in my
electives.
I mean, as a lesbian artist, I've been asked to be part of many group shows with queer curators, and there's a real hunger for that kind of exhibition cooperation. So there's quite a hunger for queer shows. Mm. So I've been really supported over the years. By that mechanism. Mm. So yeah, men and women. Mm. Yeah, it is true. Yeah. Any other questions?
Any more questions? I'm going to pass some forms around. Sorry about this, we're all a bit freezing cold out. I've only got one virus, so I don't know how it's going to work. So if you could bear with me, it would be helpful to us. So for our next debate. Shall I pass them around? Are there any more questions? Does anyone want to ask anything, even though it might be trivial, or whatever you feel? Does anyone want to ask anything?
No such thing as a trivial question.
That's true. Go on.
In the art, in the world, with like galleries and everything, it's been quite negative with how you see art. How do you keep motivated to get yourself into galleries and into social societies? I take art GCSE, I'm 15. I'm studying what's on there for my art GCSE. So how do you keep motivated, and where do you get that support from?
It's a very good question.
Yeah.
Mm. It's a very good question.
Well, people like us, hopefully, we're happy to mentor people. touch. Hopefully we can give you some ideas or whatever. I've had A-level students just want to talk to me about work.
Stay motivated. I feel like that it comes from a genuine love and passion and a desire to create. If you've got that there fundamentally, and then that's what you do, every day you wake up going, I can't believe I'm doing this. It's exciting, it's fun. Do you know what I mean? So when that's like, when you have that kind of excitement for what you do, it's never going to go away. And it doesn't matter how many negative experiences you have, you know, you've got that thing, that fire in your belly is what keeps on fueling your desire and your need to keep on producing the work that you need to produce, because that's what it is fundamentally. It's like it's almost like a compulsion, it's a need. So as long as that thing still exists in you, it doesn't matter what's happening outside, right? You still create, you still connect with your tribe, your people, you know are going to back you, right? And you just keep it moving. And as soon as you meet somebody, or a gallerist, or whoever, who is on your wavelength, who you're sharing that same kind of vibrational frequency, and it's working, stick with them. Like right now, I'm working with a German gallery called Tequila Amy. They're amazing, right? Literally been working. And that's a relationship that has evolved slowly over time. I first met them in 2018 or something. Started working with them only 2019. It's only now that I'm having the solo exhibition with them. But they're so understanding, they're so supportive. So, you know, when you, those people...
Are there people still there? There are actually, there's one person. Yeah, well, we're stopping it now. Thanks for joining.